So hello dear students, so we'll begin with module 6 today. So today we are going to have an introductory video of module 6, that is leading and controlling. So let us see first the definition of leading and controlling. So leading is otherwise called influencing. So leading is nothing but it is just guiding the people or guiding the activities of people in an organization in a proper direction, such that it is meant to achieve the organizational goals and hence the productivity of the organization. Whereas the second function, controlling, is measuring and correcting performance of an individual or performance of an organization so as to ensure that events are conformed to the plans of the management. So there are basically three steps involved in controlling process. The first step is to gather or to collect information to measure the performance of a system or of an individual. And step two is to compare this performance with certain pre-established standards. And the last step is to determine the modification, that is to measure the deviation, to see whether there is any deviation from the actual plan and the performance, and see the deviation and take corrective action. So these are the three basic steps involved in a controlling process. Now, let us see the difference between leadership and management. In most cases, we can see that the term leader and manager are interchangeably used. But definitely there are some differences between leadership and management. So let us see certain differences. The first difference is that in leadership, leaders always set direction and they always aim in creating vision. Whereas management or managers, what they do is they understand the goal of team and company. Leadership, again, the second difference, assembling team, whereas management creating and prioritizing tasks to be completed. That is, management always give priority to the task which is to be performed or which is to be completed. Leadership creates shared values, whereas management always aims in assigning the task to appropriate team members. Leaders always helps in resolving conflict. And management, of course, they helps in motivating and guiding individual contributors. Leaders know or they inspire or leads people by examples, whereas managers always review people according to their performance. And leadership changing team to the right direction, whereas management reports status up, downs and peers. So these are certain differences between leadership and management. And same you can use for difference, if difference is asked for leaders and managers also. Leadership and management, or for leaders and managers, you can use the same points. Next, let us see. The characteristics of leadership. There are many characteristics of leadership. I'll discuss five major characteristics. The first one is, it is a goal-based activity. That is, as I told you, leaders always try to influence people towards accomplishment of the goal of the particular organization. Second one is power-based activity. That is, the power of a leader position influence, definitely that will influence the employees. That is, the greater the power, the greater the leader can influence their followers. Next is universality. That is, leadership is required in all levels. It should not be confined to the top level or the middle level. It has to be there in every level or all levels of the organization. Next is influential process. Definitely a leader can influence his followers by using some creative methods or some innovative ideas, bringing out some innovative ideas, etc. Next is situational variables. A good leader is one who can work out ideas according to the situation. So definitely, leadership is a workout at a particular point of time under given circumstances. Next, let us see the various approaches in leadership. There are two different approaches in leadership. The first approach is the trait approach and the second approach is the contingency approach. So let us see what is a trait approach. Trait approach is otherwise referred to as genetic approach. So traits, as you know, that they are just the distinguishing factors or distinguishing personal characteristics of a particular person or a particular individual. That is, and this approach is based on the assumption that all great leaders have got certain inborn qualities. Okay, and that is then that is this quality will differentiate the leaders from followers. So if a person is said to be, or if a person says that he is a good leader, then according to trait approach, it means that thus that particular person has got certain inborn qualities in him, and that makes him a leader. That is, there are certain universal set of behaviors to distinguish leaders and followers. So this particular approach is otherwise called the great person theory. And so let us find out what are the strengths or what are the advantages and disadvantages of this approach. The first is that this theory categorizes the behavior of general behavior of leaders, and leadership qualities definitely can be assessed from this type of leadership trait. But weaknesses or disadvantages that it is not a helpful approach in explaining leadership. That is, traits or the general behavior are not measurable. Okay, we cannot say that how much quality or how much trait a leader is possessing or how good he is. We cannot tell that. And one thing we can say is that the behaviors or the traits are not just inborn. Some are acquired from others also. And the next is we have the contingency or situational approach in leadership. So this is a type of adjusting leadership. That is, it says that in one word, I can say that this approach says that there is no single way or no best style of leadership under all conditions. We have to adopt according to the different conditions, and we have to work out ideas, or we have to bring innovations according to the situation. So this is a type of some adjustable leadership. That is, it is a flexible type of leadership, and we have to think practically to meet different situations. So according to this, so on the basis of this contingency theory of leadership, Fiedler has developed a theory, or that theory is commonly known as, or popularly known as, Fiedler's contingency theory. And the model he developed, he called it as the Fiedler's contingency model. So you can see on the left side, I have drawn Fiedler's contingency model. It's basically based on leadership styles and situational variables. That is how it basically shows the relationship between leadership style and situation, how a leader adjusts to the situation. That is what Fiedler want to explain. So definitely this leadership model is a situational model of leadership, and it states that a leader will be efficient not only because of his traits or attributes, but due to different situations, like due to interactions with many people or interactions with group members or interactions with some expert people, etc. That is, it says that there is no best way to say that he is a good leader. If he is working out some innovative ideas according to the situations, then only we can say that he is a good leader or a great leader. And Fiedler has distinguished the leadership styles into two. One is task-oriented and second one is human relation-oriented leadership. So what is task-oriented leadership? Task-oriented leadership is that the leader is satisfied if the tasks are performed properly, or he always derives satisfaction from the task performed. Whereas in human relation style, a leader always has, or he always derives his satisfaction from various good personal relations which he keeps. So that is what Fiedler has established with this contingency model. And Fiedler also has set three factors which helps in determining the effective style of leadership. So the first factor is position power. As I already told you, position power, it is a degree up to which a power of a leader can influence his people, so that the followers will be moving towards a particular, or moving in a proper direction so as to meet the goals. Next is task structure. It is a degree to which how well the tasks are clearly explained to his followers. Next is leader-member relations. That is, it is the extent to which a leader is accepted trust. That is, it actually denotes a degree of trust. How much how much trustworthy the leader is to his followers. That is what leader member relations means. Now we have two classifications or classifications of leadership as transactional leadership and transformational leadership. So let us see the difference between the two. So first let us see transformational leadership. So transformational leadership is a type of leadership where a leader would try to bring or would always try to bring innovative and creative ideas and try to implement the same, or I can say that he always want some sort of transformations or change in his followers so that they can achieve the outcome to meet the goals. Okay, that is always the employers will be going beyond the expected day-to-day tasks. That is, they will be doing more. And the leaders will be motivating his followers to work more for the benefit of the organization. So let us see what are the strengths of this particular type of leadership. The first is that it is a better way of doing things and modify the organization systems. And weaknesses, there is a chance of conceptual clarity and conflicts can be there. Because if a leader is trying to bring more and more, it may be like followers, not all followers will be there to listen to him or to do all those tasks. So there is a chance that conflicts will arise. Next, the second type is the transactional leadership. So the transactional leadership is actually the traditional form of leadership where the goals are all preset. Okay, no innovations, no creativity, nothing is there. Only thing is that the transactional leaders always guide his followers towards the preset goals. Okay, but they can offer something like this transactional leaders can offer some valuables like some increase in salary, incentives, promotions, etc. Or they can do the reverse thing also. They can like demotions, punishments, etc. But anyway, the goals are all preset. There is no provision for creations, innovations, etc. So strength, it's like it clearly defines rules and expectations of a leader. And always it maintains the culture of the organization. And weaknesses, as I told you, creativity has no role in this. And innovations, creativity has no role. So these are that is a main weakness of this particular type of leadership. Next, we have the second section, that is controlling. So let us see the block diagram of the basic control process. You can clearly see the block diagram of the basic control process. So the first step is establishment of standards. That is, before we perform a task, what we do is we set some specific or set some standards. Okay. And we always measure or we always try to compare our performance with this actual set standards. And the standards should be clear, it should be measurable. And definitely it should go with the goals of the organization. And sometimes the standards will be generated inside the organization, or sometimes it will be generated outside. So anyway, the first step is establishment of standards. Step 2, we have measurement of actual performance. Step 3, we have comparison of actual performance with the standards. And step 4 is corrective actions if necessary. So let us see step 2. Step 2, what is step 2? Measuring actual performance. That is, we are measuring. We have a preset standards. We have a set of standards already preset. Then what we do is we measure the performance of the system or an individual. Okay. Sometimes the performance can be measured quantitatively, or sometimes it will be qualitative performance. So anyway, it has to be recorded. Okay. Whatever, whether it is quantitative or qualitative, it has to be recorded. And the next step is comparing the actual performance against the standards. See, as I told you, in step 1, we have set some standards. So now we have measured the actual performance. And the next step is to measure the deviation. That is, to check whether the actual performance is matching with the set standards. If not, we say that there is some sort of deviations. The deviations can be like, it can be sometimes the actual performance may match with the set standard. Sometimes the actual performance will be less than the set standard, or sometimes it will like go beyond the set standard. Okay, anyway, some sort of deviations will be there that will be recorded. And the next step is taking remedial actions. See, once we calculate the deviations or once the deviation is measured, what we have to do is we have to do some sort of adjustments or fine tuning so that the performance matches or conforms to the plan of the organization. Okay, and after this corrective actions, what we have to do is, if the if we have to implement, or we have to decide upon certain corrective actions, and we have to implement that. And even after the implementation of corrective actions, if the performance is not well, what we have to do is we have to reverse actions, or we have to revise our actions. Okay, so these are the steps involved in basic control process. So that is the first part, or the introductory part, of leading and controlling process. Thank you.